Good day, everyone. My name is Julien Benoit. I will be your lecturer for this Origins of Life class. So if you want to contact me, my email is there. So I'm a senior researcher at the Evolutionary Studies Institute of the University of the Witwatersrand. So you can find me at the building of the Evolutionary Studies Institute, and you can email me at this address. You can also contact me through the forum that I've put at the bottom of this lesson. So you can ask your questions on this forum during working hours, so from 8 to 3. And I think that's already quite a lot to join me. So I'm sorry in advance for the accent. This is my actual accent. This is my French accent, and I cannot help it. So I understand that sometimes it's quite difficult to get what I'm talking about. So please never hesitate to send me emails to ask if something wasn't clear, or if you could not understand what I was talking about. I'm used to it. I'm not going to be grumpy about it. So yeah, please, if there's anything you don't understand about this class, please ask me. There's no problem about that. Also, there is the slides are available right next to this video, right under the video, if everything is done correctly. So you can download the slides in addition to this presentation. By the way, I strongly suggest that you download this video so that you don't have to come back again if you want to watch it again. You can download it directly and watch it over and over to help you learn, to help your learning process. And also, I strongly encourage that even though you are not in class, that you take notes, because notes are important for the learning process. They are important for your brain to remember what you've been told. So I strongly encourage that you do it as much as possible as if it was an in-class lecture. So now, the readings. So I know at the time I'm recording this, I'm not sure if you will be able to access the libraries. So, but I nevertheless put some readings that I think are interesting. They are interesting because they present paleontology in a great South African or African context. So that book particularly is very focused on South African fossil heritage. So if you want to know everything about the great fossil record that we have in South Africa, the great paleontology that we are doing in South Africa, this is the book you want to read. And if you want something a bit more light, you can find this book, which is a lot better illustrated, and it's a lot shorter also, and it's focused on Africa in general, not only South Africa. And if you want a geological point of view of paleontology, then this is the book you're looking for. If the disruptions due to the coronavirus are still ongoing and we are still in lockdown, I've put also some Wikipedia links at the bottom of this lesson. So you scroll down all the way to the bottom of the lesson. There are Wikipedia links that I think summarize quite well what we are going to talk about during these lectures. So let's start first with boring definitions. Unfortunately, this is always the starting point to explain what we are going to talk about. So first, paleontology. What is paleontology? Paleontology, or paleontology in American, so there's paleontology in the British spelling and paleontology in the American spelling. It's the science that studies fossils. That's quite easy. Now the big question is, what is a fossil? And the fossil is any trace of life or life activity preserved in rocks. So it can be it can be many things. Many things can be fossils. It doesn't have to be an extinct species. For instance, there are fossils of Homo sapiens being our species, the human species. And the species doesn't have to be there are some extinct species, sorry, that are found, but they are not always fossils. Like, for example, a frozen mammoth. It's a mammoth that is frozen. It's not fossilized. We will see later what is the fossilization process. But sometimes you find extinct species that are not fossil. So fossil is a very broad concept, and sometimes it does not overlap completely with the concept of extinct species. That's the big idea behind this definition. But any trace of life or life activity that is preserved in rocks. So we will see a bit later what does that cover. It can be trace left by an animal, for example. So it doesn't have to be a bone or a skeleton or a body in general. And the fossil record, it's the record of ancient life and its evolution through the geological times. So that's also an important definition. I will very, very often refer to the fossil record. And you need to know what this is. The fossil record, it's basically everything that is recorded as a fossil through the geology, through the stratigraphy, through geological times. Also, maybe one thing, I've put here two possible translation of the word fossil in isiZulu. And I mean, I am unable to pronounce this, to be honest. I'm already unable to speak correct English, so I cannot speak correct Zulu. Sorry about that. But these are two possible translation of the word fossil in Zulu. So first, you can see that there's not one word to talk about fossil in Zulu. And second, you can see that these are very, very long sentences. So unfortunately, and as much as I would like to have a transformed lecture, unfortunately, I cannot play with that and do justice to the Zulu language or any African language. So, because it's just, yeah, if these are the translation for the word fossil, you can imagine what could be the word for paleontology. So to make it simple, we will stick to English. And hopefully we will all understand each other. So now a bit, a definition of paleontology will not be complete if I do not help you to distinguish it from archaeology, because many of you probably think that paleontology is archaeology are the same thing, and they are not. So paleontology, as I say, is the scientific discipline that study fossils, trace of life preserved in rocks. Archaeology, they study ancient cultural products. A cultural product is something that was made with human hands. So your hands are the key to archaeology. If it's made with hands, it's archaeological. If it's a biological product, if something has been fossilized after being made by nature itself, if I can use that metaphor, by nature itself, it's paleontology. So here are three examples. So that's a stone tool. It was made by the hand of a human. So it's archaeology. This is a skull, a skull that was discovered near Bloemfontein of an ancient human species. And this skull is a fossil. So it's paleontology. But now, if I look at this, it's a grave. It's a grave that dates, it's 200,000 years old. No, it's 90,000 years old, and it was discovered in Israel. So this grave was built by humans. The grave itself was built by human hands. So it's archaeology, but the skeleton itself is a fossil. So it's paleontology. So you can see there can be a bit of overlap between the two. So of course there is overlap between the two, but the big difference is time. It's definitely time. So if you look at this time scale here, archaeology is everything since 3.3 million years old. So if this is the zero, 3 million years old is there. It's that line here. You see that line? That's the 3 million years old line. And paleontology, it's everything else. And there's a bit of overlap here around 3 million years old. So paleontology covers almost everything, every possible trace of life since the Earth was formed 4.5 billion years old until 3 million years old. So that's the very big difference between archaeology and paleontology. It's time. Even though sometimes the objects overlaps, time is the big difference. Now let's go to the fossilization process. So I told you any trace of life that is preserved in rock is relevant to paleontology. Now, how do you go from a living being to a fossil? And the study of this process that leads you from a living being to its fossil is called taphonomy. So another definition, taphonomy is the study of fossilization process, or how do things become fossilized. And in this process, water is incredibly important because it will help naturally bury the animal. You see, the first phase, the first thing to become a fossil is death and decay. So you've probably heard about living fossils. Living fossils are not a thing. To be a fossil, you have to be dead. You cannot be a fossil and alive. So please, if you have this somewhere in your mind, the concept of living fossil, you can erase it, delete it completely, and right now. You can forget about it. A fossil is a dead thing. So first, death and decay. Usually only the hardest part of the organism that died is left behind. And this part, these hard parts have to be covered with water so that the water brings sediments. And this is why water is a crucial element in the fossilization process. It brings sediments that will naturally bury the organism. So once the organism is buried, it will last for at least a million years in average, but fossilization process can be longer or it can be shorter sometimes. But in average, we consider that 1 million years is the threshold, that it's the time that is required for a living organism to turn into a fossil. And this is called diagenesis. So diagenesis is the physical and chemical changes occurring during the conversion of sediments and organic matter to rocks. So now, given the number of definitions I gave you so far, now you understand what you have to take notes. You cannot remember all of this. Take notes of all these definitions, because we're going to use them all the time. So step three, diagenesis. You spend at least 1 million years under your sediments. The sediments are being compacted. The bone is changed into rock, and then erosion eventually exposes the fossil so that the paleontologist can find them and dig them out. So now it's time for the first quiz. So you jumped to the next video. See you just now.